that you are rewarding her steadfastness. It's only you can, Lord. You see the sacrifices. Thank you for your faithfulness. Continue to be faithful in Jesus' name. Continue to strengthen her hands, her feet, in the name of Jesus, that she will declare your counsel. She will sing forth your glory. You will give her even more songs, Lord, in the name of Jesus, as she will have hands to be a ready writer in the name of the Lord Jesus. I thank you that as you give her the music and the lyrics, that she will write them, she will declare them, she will present them, and it will be without fear as you're opening the doors and making ways in Jesus' name. And we thank you that the song of the Lord will go throughout the world even in the name of Jesus, that your name will be glorified and your people edified in the name of the Lord Jesus.
I see the word of God as a hammer, and he said it's breaking up fallow ground, it's breaking up hard and stony places, it's breaking up stony hearts, it's breaking the power of the enemy. And I hear the Lord saying, even as you preach, decree, declare in the highway, the byway, the hedge, the pulpit, the store, wherever you go, I hear the Lord saying, even as I have anointed thee, fear not, even as people say, what got into him? It's me, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you. I thank you for the Spirit of God that is in store. A steadfast spirit, Lord God. Something that is rare today. Father, you said the race isn't given to the swift, but to those that endure to the end. I thank you that the end is a long way away, for with long life you're going to satisfy him as he continues to endure and persevere, not only in lifting up the name of Jesus through the worship, Lord God, but with his actions, with his deeds, as well as being an instrument of leadership, an instrument of your peace for men to follow as he follows Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, Mark, Pam, Odalia, Joel. Am I missing anybody? Okay, Doc, I'll just lay hands on you and you stand for them in proxy. Father, in the name of Jesus, hallelujah. I thank you for the course of the anointing through their body, that it produces more worship. And that they are not afraid to praise you in the sanctuary in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Increase the anointing in Mark. Increase the anointing on Joel. Hallelujah. Even in the instrument, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Increase the praise in Odalia, Lord God. Hallelujah. Lord God, continue to go through Pam. Increasing, Lord, even that gift of singing, Lord God. And the acting and all the gifts that you've given, Lord, to these people. I thank you that the gifts are for you and they're not going to be hidden under a bushel. They're not going to be hidden. They're not going to be sometimey with the sometimey flesh. I'm in, I'm out. I curse sickness and disease in this choir and in the congregation as we dare to praise you, Lord God, that the Holy Ghost come down and fill us with your healing virtue. We already have salvation, but then we will have cups, vessels, overflowing with praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay. I got the mic. Praise God. When This morning I was praying, God gave me a vision for the choir. And what it is, how many of you know about American Idol or America's Got Talent? And God said, because of your intention to worship Him, He's taken the choir to a new level in worship and praise. And He said, today, He pushed the golden buzzer. So all the glory is coming down now and the worship is going up. God said, it is so. He's pushed the golden buzzer because of your intention to worship Him.
Choir, be encouraged. Be encouraged because when you guys are up there, the anointing is there. The anointing is there because you guys aren't performing for us. You're worshiping the Lord.
Yeah.
You're blessing the Lord. And even when it seems like only four or five people are there, for some reason it seems like hundreds are singing. It sounds like angels are singing. And that's because you guys are doing it for the Lord. You're not doing it for man. You're worshiping the Lord. And because of the gifts that He's given you, you guys are giving back to Him and doing it for His glory. So just be encouraged. Be encouraged. It doesn't matter when you look to the left or to the right how many people are sitting next to you. You're going to sound big because God is big. We serve a large God. So be encouraged.
The Lord knows what we need. And He is not a man that He should lie. His word is yea and amen. And we receive it. Long, strong, healthy life. And we see ourselves bursting at the seams. This choir is growing. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 We agree. Thank you. Thank you so much. Do we have any first-time visitors to the Los Angeles Shabbat Four Square Church this morning? Any first-time visitors? No visitors for the moment. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
God's got it.
God's got it.
And He's got you.
And He's got you.
Amen. We're going to receive ministry and song with Psalm Shabbat.
Praise the Lord.
Does everybody have a red or an orange folder?
No.
We're going to learn we're going to do a sing-along this morning. No. With Psalm Shabbat. Cynthia, make sure your pastor has one. And the song is Love is the More Excellent Way. Choir, would you stand, please?
There you go.
So everybody sing this. Love is the more excellent way. Everybody, again.
Love is the more excellent way.
So we're going to sing, and then when we get to that part, you all are going to join us, and then we're going to do the chorus. Love is patient, love is kind. Do you see that?
Yes.
Love is humble all of the time, not easily angered, enduring the test, so never forget. Love is the more excellent way.
Love is the more excellent way.
But if I don't have love, anything until you get it in your spirit. Praise God. Thank you.
Love is the more excellent way. Amen. And it's evangelism time, where we're always supposed to show love, because it is the excellent way. Amen. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your requests known unto God, and the peace of God that passes all understanding shall be yours.
Amen.
Who wants to live in peace today?
Amen.
Amen. Our topic today is restlessness. And restlessness is the opposite of peace.
Amen.
Restlessness is when you're unable to rest. You're unable to relax. Your mind is racing. Your thoughts are racing. You're filled with anxiety, restlessness. And this topic is coming from our book, Extreme Answers to Life's Tough Questions. And we're talking about restlessness, and there are many causes of restlessness. What have you noticed about some people? What are some things that you see in people who are restless? Anyone?
Restless leg syndrome.
Okay, where the leg keeps moving? Okay.
I used to do that. My mother said, your body is to be in every part of your body. I said, I'm fine. She said, no. She said, tell your leg to stop moving.
Okay.
Every time she takes her time, she takes her time.
Praise God.
I would just rub my leg.
All the things that it leads to, even a stroke and heart attack. Your body has to have rest.
Amen.
You can't keep it going 24/7, okay? So speak to your body if anything isn't rested in it, including your mind. Thoughts. Tell them to stop racing. You command in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Easily agitate.
Inability to concentrate. Talking non-stop without taking a breath.
Non-stop talking, not taking a breath. Carl.
Worry.
Sleeplessness. Can't sleep. Insomnia.
Can't sleep. Can't eat.
Irritation.
Some people eat too much.
Irritation.
Fidgetiness. Amen. Okay. Yes. Now, does God want us to live like that?
No,
He does not want us to be restless. Where we have no peace. And you know what? He has given us peace.
Yes.
And we are to walk in that peace. We worry about the future. What will the end be like? It's going to be like it is. But we need to trust God. Do you know that when your mind is racing and you're restless, you can confront that restlessness with a truth of the word. The truth of the word. You can find scriptures that addresses what God says about your situation. Because God said, when the trials and tribulations come, the things that you go through, you don't have to be surprised. Because he said he has overcome the world. Has he overcome the world? Did he say that? Therefore, you have a choice. You can walk in fear or you can stand on the promises of God. Amen? What are some things that people do to overcome restlessness? Some people exercise. They might go for a walk. Some people sing. Some people pray. Some people find a safe person to talk with about their situation. One who can give godly feedback. Amen? Some people do drink to dull that restless feeling. Some people take drugs, and they could be prescribed or they could be illegal to help that restlessness go away, or so they think. Some people do what this song says. Have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about our troubles. He'll hear our fainted cry, and he will answer from on high. When you feel a little prayer wheel turning, you know that the fire is burning. When you have a little talk with Jesus, that makes it what? It makes it right. Why does it make it right? Because when you know that Jesus hears and he answers, it's well with my soul. It's all right with me. What does all of this have to do with evangelism? Everything. More than likely, you will have to deal with people who are restless, people who are anxious, and you need to be prepared and equipped to show them how to come out of that restless state. Evangelism is not just about ministering to strangers. It might be a friend. It might be a family member. It might be you. Be not anxious about anything, but in all things, with prayer and supplication, make your request known unto God, and the peace of God that passes all understanding shall be yours. Amen? Any testimonies?
Oh my goodness.
Johnny on the spot. She's doing her job.
The Lord is good. He's worthy to be praised.
Amen.
And this testimony has to do with restlessness.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. I go to the convalescent home and minister in the convalescent home there. The last time I was there, there was a lady in the convalescent home who was extremely restless, and she evidently was irritating all of the other people in the convalescent home, but I praise God, she wasn't irritating me. I knew she had a problem, and when I would start talking, she would blurt out, and most of the time, her blurting out had nothing to do with what I was talking about.
Amen.
And so I said, honey, I'm going to give you 5 minutes to say everything you want to say, and so get everything off your heart in those 5 minutes, and after that, I want you to be quiet. Well, she had her 5 minutes, and when I started talking, she started blurting out again about her mama, daddy, and grandpa. And so the people in the group were extremely irritated with her. But I praise the Lord that there was actually no irritation in me. And I talked to the other people and I said, please stop getting so irritated with her, because evidently she has a need to talk and we shouldn't stop her. Let her say what she has to say and you stop getting to it. The problem is not hers. The problem is yours. Right. You ought to be able to live with people with their problems. And so, by the time we got finished, I finally got through the lesson. And she thanked me and said, I thank you for not becoming upset with me about me blurting out every 5 minutes. I said, well, praise God. I said, because all of us sometimes have something that, on our hearts that we need to say. And I'm glad that you found the freedom to say it here. And I'm not irritated with you, but you have to know how to control yourself. And she said, thank you. So.
Praise God. He's faithful. Fred Pitts.
Wonderful that Fred is not restless. Amen. Sorry. Overlooked the announcements. Announcements for March 10, 2019. Coming attractions. Our inspirational verse is, herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. That's 1 John 4:17. Bible study is Tuesday, March 12th. Anger workshop will begin from 12 to 1 p.m., 6 to 7 p.m. as well. The Sermon on the Mount, 1 to 2 p.m., 7 to 8 p.m. These are the Bible studies that will be given on March 12th, this coming Tuesday. Amen. Ministry Forum meets Monday, March 11th at 3 p.m. Living Epistles will meet Monday, March 11th at 6 p.m. Feet of Fire Men's Rehearsal. Woo-hoo! Yes! Feet of Fire Men's Rehearsal is Wednesday, March 13th at 6:30 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. We are so looking forward to the men whose feet is on fire. Amen. That's all right with me. Psalm Shabbat. Yes. No, it is not too late for some more to get in. Anybody who wants to join, if you have any men whose feet are on fire, come on. Wednesday, March 13th. Pastor said if they're not on fire, you can still come. Okay, and they just might catch a fire in your head. Yes. Psalm Shabbat will meet Thursday evening, March 14th, 7 to 8:30 p.m. And if you are interested in singing, come on. Amen. We have an open invitation just for you. Amen. Men of Shabbat will meet with Cornelius Stewart, that's Pop Stewart, today, immediately following service. So please don't leave men. Men of Shabbat, please meet with Pastor Cornelius Stewart today, immediately following morning service. You will probably meet here in the choir stand. Is that right, Pastor Stewart? Amen. So don't leave men. Meet Pastor Stewart. Amen. Mighty Men of Valor will meet on Saturday, March 16th, 9 to 11 a.m. All of our men of Shabbat, that's you. You are our men of valor. Amen. So you will meet on Saturday, March 16th at 9 to 11 a.m. Men's Day is March 31st. Woo! Please be here for Men's Day. Please, you don't want to miss it. Our men put on such a wonderful, wonderful act concerning the Last Supper and everything else in between. It is so good. Might I say, every year it gets gooder and gooder. I got any witnesses? Oh, come on. Come on, I got a lot of witnesses. gets gooder and gooder. I mean, it does. Amen. Please allow me that gooder and gooder. Be sure to check out our website, www.lasfc.org. Secure online giving, church services, and events are available February 2018 through to present. Amen. You can also get sermons and events from our YouTube channel at doing YouTube search for Los Angeles Shabbat. Amen.
We have been there.
Amen. Please remember to let us know of healings, miracles, and decisions for Christ the Lord has allowed through your personal ministry efforts. This information can be written on the bottom of the giving envelope and will be included in the monthly reports to Foursquare. Thank you for your cooperation and partnership in doing the works of an ambassador. Amen. Each and every one of us are sent out to preach the gospel. Everywhere you go, the supermarket, the bus bench, wherever you are, wherever your feet land, you are commissioned to be that ambassador. Amen. Sometimes it's just a smile. Sometimes it's just acknowledging a person's presence. Sometimes it's just a listening ear. People need to talk and need to be heard. And you are sent there to do just that. Amen. Anyone celebrating a birthday today or this week, please stand and remain standing. Amen. God bless you. Amen.
As an addendum, last Sunday we told you about the demise of Melvin and Ahmad's grandmother. She will have a wake. So, it will happen this Thursday, from 11 to 1. And so, if at all possible, if you could sacrifice and let's support Melvin and Ahmad with your presence, if you can, Thursday from 11 to 1. Amen.
Where?
Come on, tell somebody this is evangelism. Yeah, it'll be here. I'm sorry, I didn't say that. Here, Thursday morning, 11 to 1. When did I say?
Thursday morning, 11 to 1.
What Thursday?
This Thursday.
This Thursday, okay?
The
14th. The 14th of March, okay? And we would just be so appreciative, even if you just come and pray. Because much prayer is needed, so that would be cool. That'd be great. Thank you. Yeah, it's not a, and it won't be long for real. It's not one of those go on and on and on and on. 11 to 1. Okay? Thank you so much. Yes, ma'am. The family is going to gather after the services at Hometown Buffet. Yeah. Any other questions? Thank you so much for your consideration. We'll now have Ministry of Music for Brother Pitts.
You try not to let those type of things happen to you, but oh Lord, I think I needed to laugh.
That's Pitt's back in patience.
Thank you.
church to be a place where grace and love come together.
Amen.
One time, my niece dressed up like a bum, and no one recognized her. She was a member of the church. And she came to my house and said, the Lord told me to do this. So I said, come on. She said, he told me to go to Bible study like this. I said, come on. And she was not received well. People were snatching their kids. Don't go up there. There's a bum up there. My niece was dramatic. She was scratching and reaching for my liquor bottle. And I said, oh, Lord, hey, was this you? It was God. And he showed us our ugly selves.
Amen.
Ugly!
Jesus.
Amen. The church is a place where people may not have the perfume on that you have.
Amen.
They're different. Can they come in if they're hungry?
Yes, they
are. Can they come in if they come down to the altar and bow because that was their tradition? Can they come in with a rosary because they came out of the Catholic Church? Can they come in?
Can they come in?
As they are. And not be judged. And sing it again. Father said, I'm going to go for that.
Jesus.
All right now.
You can do it.
You can do it.
Yes, you can.
Selling themselves to survive, not understanding the hope they can find in a place where God's love is alive. They doubt that they could meet the standards necessary, and fear they find judgment rather than a sanctuary. This must be the place where a broken heart can mend. This must be the place where the if our hand still holds a stone, and they feel that be so great to us, there's no greater than our own. This must be the point where shame meets grace, and this must be destruction begins. They doubt the church could have the answers necessary, and fear they find rejection rather than a sanctuary. This must be the place. For we cannot lift the fallen.
for the word.
Amen.
The word will be heard through the mouth of Minister Joyce Wilbur.
Praise the Lord. This is the place. This is the place. Praise God. Thought Jesse was going to preach my sermon. He used my scriptures and everything. He is amazing. He knows what we need. And he knows in what doses we need it too. Praise God.
Hi, Odalia.
Welcome home. Praise God. I'm going to share with you on overcoming fear and anxiety, which is akin to restlessness. Anxiety is defined as being troubled and uneasy in your mind. It's a nagging feeling that something is wrong or will go wrong. And anxiety comes from fear-based thoughts, just like restlessness. And many times people are paralyzed, can't move forward because of anxiety and fear in their lives. And God doesn't want us to be afraid of anything. The Bible said that he has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and what?
Sound
mind. He wants us to operate with that sound mind all the days of our lives. Turn to Luke 10. We're going to look at verses 38 to 42. I'm going to go ahead and read Luke 10, 38 to 42. Now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village, talking about Jesus, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. 39. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me. And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. In the Amplified, it said that Martha received and welcomed Jesus into her house. But for what purpose? Because she was busy doing many things, perhaps preparing the food, getting the best china out, baking bread, getting the chairs and the table ready, and who knows how many people had showed up. Maybe it was more than she had expected. And she became agitated and anxious. And when it says that she received and welcomed Jesus in her house, this is our house. Our heart is our house where we receive Jesus. But for what purpose? Why do we receive Jesus? So we can be busy about doing many things? One thing is needful, and that thing is this right now, getting the word of God, coming to church, hearing the word, so you can live a productive life, so you can have success in your life. Everybody wants to be successful, and God has all the keys to success right here in his word. But we have to be followers of Christ as dear children. We have to follow his lead. We have to follow his voice. We have to be obedient, humble, and submission to him. We have to allow him to shepherd us if we're going to have success in our life. when we're busy about many things, sometimes what we're doing, the Lord and His purpose gets lost in what we're doing. And we get off track. We want to stay on track. Believe it or not, this life is but a vapor. And if you live to be 120 years, you're going to look back and say, that went fast. I mean, it's short. I mean, really, you think about it. I mean, I worked 35 years on a job, and I mean, the time went like that. But thank God that we can walk with the Lord, and we can do much better from this day on. Amen. It said in verse 39 that Mary sat at the Lord's feet and was listening to His teaching. Martha was overly occupied, too busy, distracted, worried about outward preparation rather than the preparation of her heart. And that's what we need to be concerned about, the preparation of our heart. Martha didn't realize how off course she was and the seriousness of distractions. The enemy wants you to be distracted. Yes. The enemy doesn't want you to finish your course. He wants you to take another turn and go a different way than what the shepherd, Jesus the shepherd, tells you to do. He wants you not to be a part of a church fellowship. He wants you to be offended and leave. But who are you going to listen to? You know, we have so many reasons to be offended. I mean, on our job, at home, in the church. That's why this must be the place where we receive everyone just the way they are. We tell people to come as they are, but then they come, and we don't want to be bothered with them. We can't be those people. We have to be the type of people that welcome and love everyone. Love is the more excellent way. And we have to choose God's way. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. In verse 41, it said, Jesus said, Martha, you're careful. Careful means full of care and troubled. The Amplified says, Martha, you're anxious and troubled, meaning vexed, distressed, and disturbed. And in verse 42, in the King James, it says, one thing is needful. The Amplified says there is only need of one thing. Give us this day our daily bread. That's the one thing we need. And it said that in the Passion Translation, it says Mary has chosen the best part. We choose to hear the word. We choose to spend time with the Lord. We choose to come to church and to fellowship with believers. We choose to pray. We choose to follow the Lord and to do what He tells us to do. That's our choice. And we can choose not to follow the Lord. We choose to tithe. We choose to give. We can choose not to do those things. But what a great, great blessing. What great blessings God has in store when we choose His way. I mean, he said that if you tithe, He's going to open the windows of heaven. Can you even imagine with your mind how big the windows of heaven is? I mean, it's mind-boggling. If it was just this ceiling right here, and God just poured out His blessing from this ceiling, what we can see right here, that would be a great, great blessing. If money just started raining down.
Praise God, hallelujah.
I would like that. Praise God. But He's faithful. And if we're faithful to do His word, He's faithful to come through on His promises. Praise God. Jensen Franklin, I was watching TV the other day, and Jensen Franklin, who is an amazing pastor and teacher, I mean, just sold out to the Lord from a young man. And he's on Channel 40, and he was saying that his dad was a pastor, and he had several brothers. I believe there were about five of them, but there were a lot of them, and they lived in a small house. And his dad made a prayer room study out of a closet right off of the main room, and he said it was really, really small. And he said that when his brothers and he would come in, he could hear his dad praying in his prayer closet and studying. And he said he understood the importance of prayer from a young man. And God called Jensen Franklin the pastor when he grew older. And he said that in the early days, he had a consistent prayer time. But as the church grew busier and he had more things that he had to do, he said that he got away from his prayer time and he wasn't as consistent. And he was wondering why things weren't moving as quickly in his church as he wanted them to, or why things weren't progressing in his life. And he said God woke him up one morning and said, he said God would wake him up every morning, but he wouldn't get out of the bed because he was so tired being cumbered about doing too many things. And he said God spoke to him and said, I have a standing appointment with you every morning. If you miss it, I will still be there.
Amen.
If you miss it, I will still be there. Hallelujah. And God has an appointment for each and every one of us daily, daily. If we miss it, he's still gonna be there. He's gonna be waiting. So don't miss your appointment, amen? Anxiety comes from perceived threats, which result in our misguided thought life. Because anxiety is in your thought life. In Proverbs 21:8, it says, the wicked flee when no man pursueth, but the righteous are bold as a lion. I grew up in New York, and my mother had a green thumb, and she'd grow these beautiful, beautiful plants. And she had she'd grow geraniums in the front. And she had plants in the house, and I mean, she had a green thumb. And on the side of the house was mint growing wild. And if you know how expensive mint is today, if I knew back then. And in the back of the house, there were beautiful tall sunflowers. And I mean, when I think of it, and we had roses, it was like the Garden of Eden. But I remember one day I was outside and I was stung by a yellowjack on my hand. And my that area swelled up. And after that, whenever a bee was around me, I would, you know, I'd go waving the bee and moving around and, you know, all this. And the bee might have just taken off and gone in another direction, and I'm still swatting. And that's that's the visual of the wicked flee when no man pursueth. You know, having that anxiety and thinking something's gonna hurt you, and it's nowhere near you. God's got us. God's got us in every situation. God's got us every day of our lives. Hallelujah. My daughter Erin was in a car accident. She gave her testimony. It was over a year ago. And God so graciously spared her life. And she works a security position in the evenings from 4 to 12. And she, I plead the blood of Jesus over my girls every day. I pray Psalm 91 protection every day. And she got to work yesterday and she called me and she said, guess what? I said, what? She said, something told me not to go up Van Ness up Van Ness to San Vicente. And I said, yeah, that was the Lord. She said, there was a major accident on Van Ness. And she said, and I just missed it. She said, by minutes. I said, thank you, Jesus. The footsteps of the righteous are ordered by the Lord. And I thank God that she has ears to hear. She had an ear to hear what God was saying to her, and she obeyed. Hallelujah. Never stop praying for your kids. Never stop praying for your kids. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Proverbs 28:1, the Passion Bible says, guilty criminals experience paranoia even though no one threatens them. It is good. Luke 8:14 says, the sower sows the word, and as for what, okay. Luke 8:14 is about the sower, Jesus, sowing the word. And the scripture says, and as for what fell on thorns, these are the people who hear it. But as they go on their way, they are choked and suffocated with the anxieties and riches and pleasures of life, and their fruit does not ripen or come to maturity or perfection. Anxiety and fear can keep you from bearing fruit in the kingdom. Because if you're walking in anxiety and fear, you're not going to walk out what God tells you to walk out. Okay? Because you're trying to preserve yourself. You're trying to protect yourself. You're trying to control the situation. And you're missing out on the best part of your life. Serving Jesus is the best thing you could ever do in life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Proverbs 15:15. I'm just going to read it. It said, in the Amplified, it says, all the days of the desponding and afflicted are made evil by anxious thoughts and foreboding. Their thoughts are disturbed and they're anxious. And it says, all their days are made evil. And as I was reading last night, it said that many times anxiety begins in childhood with children. And then it progresses if it's not addressed. So pay attention to your children and what it is they're going through, what they're dealing with, their fears. Pray for them. Lay hands on them. You know, minister to them. Because you don't know what they're dealing with throughout the day or how they perceive things in their environment. And the media and social media is a great part of anxiety inducing and producing. I have to turn the TV off. I have to turn the news off. I have to turn the news off. I have to turn it off. It's too violent. And you know that they pick and choose what they want to show you. You know that. You know it's controlled by the enemy. And I remember I turned it on, and in 5 minutes, I don't know, they had talked about 7 murders and catastrophes, and I just turned it off. Amen. You have control over your environment. You can turn it off. You don't have to listen to that. You don't have to allow that to get into your eye gate or your ear gate, because that's going to stay with you, at least for a little while. And then the enemy might bring it up. So pay attention to what you're listening to. Musical lyrics. Pay attention to what you're listening to and what you're hearing. Amen?
Amen.
If we don't deal with the things that drive us, they will deal with us. And anxiety is like growing weeds in your mind. I don't mean marijuana weeds. I mean weeds in your mind. You know, the rain caused my grass to grow, everybody's grass to grow, but also with the grass came up weeds, lots of weeds. And anxiety can be like that. Your thoughts, I mean, it's weeds that block the word of God or block productive thoughts. And if you don't deal with it and speak the word, then that stuff is going to fester. And the enemy always wants to amp it up, take it to another level. He doesn't want you just to be a little bit anxious. He wants it to grow. He wants it to consume your life. So, and it's that way with fear. It's that way with any kind of, let's say, a cold or sickness. The devil doesn't want it to remain a cold. I mean, he wants it to be full blown. He wants to amp things up in our lives to stop us. But we have to be smarter than him. The Bible said that we are not ignorant of his devices. And we're not ignorant of his devices when we get this word. Amen? Turn to Philippians chapter 4, please. Philippians 4, verse 6. I'm going to read verses 6 through 9. I have the King James. Be careful for nothing. Want to read with me? But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. Those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me do, and the God of peace shall be with you. Praise God. In the Amplified, it says, do not fret. Be careful for nothing. It says, do not fret or have anxiety about anything, but in every circumstance and in everything, by prayer and petition or definite requests, with thanksgiving, continue to make your wants known to God. And understand that when you make your wants known, He's listening. He's hearing. He's moving. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. And then God tells us in verse 8 what to think on. He said, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, honest, whatsoever things are just, pure, lovely, of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. And I have to, from time to time, if my mind starts to think on something that is, one minister calls them junk thoughts, and they are junk. They're thoughts that the enemy, you know, just kind of throws at you. And I'll stop and I'll say, no, I think of those things that are true, honest, lovely, of a good report, and of praise. Always have a scripture ready. And you actually want to have more than one scripture ready. Because you think about it, when the devil tempted Jesus, he spoke to him three times. Three, one, two, three, knockout punch. Okay? So have your scriptures ready. You need to write them down on cards. God has not given me the spirit of fear, but of power of love and of a sound mind. You know, take it and put it on your mirror, or carry it in your purse or in your wallet, whatever it is you need to do, because we're fighting a fierce warfare today. I mean, it's fierce. When you look at some of the things that are going on around us, I know it's been said before, but with the way people drive, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. I mean, really? Absolutely, you got to have those angels. You got to remind yourselves that the angels of the Lord are encamped around about you. Hallelujah. To keep you in all your ways. To keep you in all your ways. When you're walking, on the bus, you're in your car, the angels of the Lord are encamped around about you. Remind yourself of that. Remind yourself. Hallelujah. In John 14, 1, it says, let's turn to that. John 14, 1. Thank you, Jesus. And remember that when we read the word, God is talking to you. When I read the word, God is talking to me. Amen. John 14, 1 says, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. So he's saying, you let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Jesus is talking. We have a responsibility to not let our hearts be troubled. When trouble comes, we need to recognize when our heart is troubled or we're anxious about something or we're fearful about something, we need to recognize that this is not from God, it's from the enemy. And we need to remember, I'm not going to let my heart be troubled about this because God has a remedy. God is with me. He'll never leave me nor forsake me. Hallelujah. Verse 16, Jesus said, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. He is the great, great comforter. The Holy Spirit is the great comforter. And God knew that we would need comfort. He knew we would need comfort. He knew that things were going to happen in our lives. And he wants us to be comforted. He wants us to experience comfort. Not agitation, not anxiety, but comfort. And he comforts us through his word. Obeying God doesn't translate into comfort for our flesh, but it will bring comfort to our souls. Because you know when you've obeyed God, God asked you to do something and you did it, you feel good. Hallelujah. And you're comforted. Hallelujah. There is mild anxiety and anxiety disorders which can become obsessions. And obsessions are unrestrained thoughts. In 2 Corinthians 10:5, it says that we must cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, which is the word of God. Any thought that tries to exalt itself against, any negative thought that tries to exalt itself against the knowledge of God or the word of God, we have to cast those down. And we cast them down with the word. We take authority over them. And those thoughts can be imaginings, reasonings, or popular thoughts. In the Passion Bible, for that same scripture, it says, we can demolish every deceptive fantasy that opposes God and break through every arrogant attitude that is raised up in defiance of the true knowledge of God. We capture like prisoners of war, every thought, and insist that it bow in obedience to the Anointed One. That's the power we have with our words. That's the power we have with the Word of God. But we have to do it. We have to do it. We have to do it. It's not enough to know it. We have to do it. We have to know that we can speak against our thoughts, negative thoughts. Obsessions begin with, so anxieties can become obsessions, and obsessions can control your life. Obsessions begin with attempts to control the uncertainties of life by thinking through the problem and its possibilities. And I want to read, this sheet I got through a class I'm taking. And the name of the series is Taking Time to Quiet Your Soul. And so this is mishandling anxiety with controlling behaviors. Perfectionistic behaviors are characterized by a preoccupation with orderliness in one or more areas of life in order to control the sense of vulnerability and to extinguish the doubts. They are most often driven by a fear of losing control and accompanied by the pride of accomplishment when successful. Preoccupation with keeping physical appearances. So these are some controlling behaviors. I must dress myself and my children in matching outfits and accessories. No, I never did that. I must not wear the same clothes within a 3-week rotation. I must not wear anything that shows I am not up on the latest fashion. I must not be seen anywhere without my makeup. I must not wear clothes that are not perfectly pressed or shoes that are not perfectly polished. Now, of course, you want to look your best, but when these things rule your thoughts, that's not healthy. Any imbalance is not healthy. Preoccupation with keeping surroundings in order. I must always have a perfectly clean house. Well, I feel that one. I will use a Q-tip and a toothbrush if necessary. I must vacuum the house at least 3 times a day to be really clean. No. I must have all the books on the bookshelf in precise alphabetical order and sitting with the same distance from the spine of the books to the outer edge of the shelf. I must rotate the furniture in every room often enough so that the carpet wears evenly in all places. I must not let anyone think the carpet is worn excessively in any spot.
Wow.
I must redecorate the Christmas tree so that it is perfect after the kids have tried to decorate it. I must have the absolute perfect Christmas gift for everyone at Christmas, or I have failed to show them I love them. I don't know if you see yourself in any of these, but
amen.
I used to spend hours Christmas shopping trying to find the perfect gift, and it never happened. I must stack every piece of clothing in my dresser drawer so that they are perfectly uniform. I must arrange everything in my closet so that all the hangers go the same way. I like to do that. And the blouses are arranged by color in the order of the rainbow. No. I must not allow anyone to touch anything on my desk, stapler, note cards, letter opener, and so forth. I want to know precisely where they are. Remember, these are controlling behaviors. But I did that actually when I was teaching. I don't like the kids touching my desk. Preoccupation with keeping performance in order. I must practice more than the teacher requires so that I can play my violin piece perfectly for my next lesson. I cannot miss any notes. I must know ahead of time if I'm going to accompany the song service at church. I will not play if there's a chance I will mess something up. I must hit all the baskets whenever I shoot in the game. I must have a clear desk and inbox before I allow myself to go home at night. I must work 50 to 60 hours a week to show the boss I'm not a slacker. I must take the time to look through every newspaper and magazine for coupons so that I am a good steward of my money. I must keep the kids on a strict schedule for everything from their wake-up time until bedtime if I am to develop a responsible character in them. I must raise and provide for my family the Walton way. I should bake my own bread, milk my own goats, sew on the clothes for myself and my children, grow my own garden, can my own fruits and vegetables, and raise my own chickens. Preoccupation with keeping spiritual disciplines in order. I must be sure to do my devotions every day or God will judge me for my unfaithfulness. I must volunteer for every need that is announced at church or I'm not being a servant to others. Preoccupation with keeping finances in order. I must spend whatever time is necessary on the internet to be sure that the model of appliance I am purchasing is the best deal for my money. So you get the picture. Preoccupation with keeping relationships in order. I must call my daughter at college every day so she can see how much I love her. She probably wouldn't want that. Obsessions can also, remember these are controlling behaviors, and there are compulsive behaviors too. Ritualistic behaviors, repeated hand washing, extended shower routines, checking and rechecking locks, stove controls, electrical sockets, test answers, touching certain items in a precise sequence before leaving a room, or performing certain routines before driving, repeatedly asking for assurances of love and forgiveness, and so on. And then there are destructive behaviors, self-inflicted injury, cutting, burning, standing up for hours without moving, exercising to exhaustion. I know people that do that. Sticking pins into the body, pulling out hair, pulling out eyebrows, starving, anorexia, scratching the skin until it bleeds, and so forth. So my whole purpose for reading that is to let you know that anxieties can take you there, can lead to compulsive behaviors. And so we want to nip it in the bud with the word. Amen. Psalms 23, we have to realize that we can't control everything in our lives. God has given us dominion through the word of God, by speaking the word of God, but you can't control everyday circumstances. And I really don't want to. The Bible says in Psalms 23:1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And if we allow him to shepherd us, he's going to lead us in the way we should go. It also says in Proverbs, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Amen?
Amen.
In John, 3 John 2, the Bible says, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. Our soul is our mind, our will, and our emotions. And God wants us to prosper in our minds. He doesn't want us to be plagued with anxieties, obsessive thoughts. And I have dealt with anxiety over the years about different things. And I thank God that I could put the word on those feelings of anxiety, or those feelings of fear. I thank God that I have overcome in many areas. And it's not something I have to live with or manage. You know how that people say, well, you need to manage, you know, this illness. You don't need to manage anything. You don't need to manage anxiety, because God will deliver you from anxiety. You don't need to manage fear. God will deliver you from fear if you allow him to. You don't need to manage anything. What are we managing it for? It's not supposed to be a part of our lives. You know, we're living, and we're managing it, we're living beneath our privileges. God wants to take us up higher. He wants to take us up to another level. Hallelujah. Praise God. And the last scripture is 1 Peter 5, 6 through 9. I'm going to read it in the Amplified. It says, therefore, humble yourselves, demote, lower yourselves in your own estimation under the mighty hand of God. In your own estimation. Interesting. Under the mighty hand of God, that in due time he may exalt you. Casting the whole of your care, all of your anxieties, worries, all of your concerns once and for all on him. For he cares for you affectionately and cares about you watchfully. He never slumbers nor sleeps. He's always watching over us. He's always with us. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. Goodness and mercy are behind us. I mean, the angels of the Lord are encamped around about us. Look at how much protection we have. We have nothing to be worried about, nothing to be fearful about, but we have to remind ourselves of that. In verse 8, it says, be well balanced, temperate, sober of mind. Be vigilant and cautious at all times. For the enemy, the devil, roams about like a roaring lion, seeking someone to seize upon and devour. Withstand him and be firm in faith. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Praise the Lord. If there's anyone here who has not received Jesus as your Savior, this is the most important decision you could ever make in this life. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And you can know with a surety that you're saved today. Is there anyone here who would like to receive Jesus as your Savior and start a brand new life with a loving Savior who's paid the price for your sins, who's given you the benefit of a covenant and covenant blessings that are unending? Is there anyone here who would like to receive Jesus as Savior? Perhaps you are saved and you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. This is the power gift that God wants you to have so you can go forth and be his ambassador in this world. In Acts 2:4 it says, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit of God gave them the utterance. How many of you speak in tongues and know that it is a wonderful, wonderful gift? Hallelujah. It aids us, it strengthens us. Praise God. Thank God you can speak in tongues at any time, in your car, in your house, in your shower, in your bed. Hallelujah. I know that you're praying the perfect prayer regarding any situation. So if there's anyone here who would like to receive the infilling of the Holy Spirit, you can come forth, or if you need to be saved, or perhaps you need a church home. We would love for you to be a part of this church body. We would love for you to join arms with us and to do spiritual warfare here at Shabbat. We have two wonderful pastors, and if you come and join us, we will love on you, encourage you, and bless you. Go to pastor's office, please.
And there are three or four that didn't stand, but I'll take care of you. Okay, God bless.
Praise God. Thank you. Thank you, all children, for standing. Or perhaps you need assurance of salvation. Maybe you were saved, or as a child, or your grandma was saved, and you're not sure if you're saved, and you would like assurance of salvation. We also offer that. So for any of those, you can come forward or raise your hand and someone will minister to you after the service. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Is there anyone who needs prayer regarding anxiety or fears? If you would stand at your seat, I'd be happy to pray for you regarding any area of your lives that the enemy has attacked you with anxiety, fears, or obsessions of any kind. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, I give you glory and honor for your people. I thank you, Lord God, that the entrance of your word brings light. And I break the power of every spirit of anxiety. I break the power of every spirit of fear. I bind up yokes of fear, Lord God, over your people. I take authority over compulsive and obsessive behaviors, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Father, that whom the Son has set free is free indeed in the name of Jesus. We just give you glory and honor, Father, for a new walk with you, for a new talk, Lord God. We thank you, Father, for new fellowship, for new communion. And I thank you, Father, that these will branch out, move out, run toward what you're telling them to do, Lord, this day. In Jesus' name, and they'll run without fear. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God.
Come and bless the Lord for the word. Hallelujah.
tell three people, God has not given me the spirit of fear. But the power. Come on, tell three people that I have a sound mind. I may not look like it. I don't always act like it. But I have a sound mind. Amen. Praise God. Many times people get disconnected from the word because we don't understand that it is alive and well. Amen. The word doesn't have you in la-la land. Ignoring what is real. Yeah. And some of us know sometimes we don't act like we have a sound mind.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
Okay. So Amen. A lot of folks like to be entertained and have jokes and pretend. But you better tell the truth so you can shame the devil. Well, amen.
Amen.
You need to know what your mountain is so you can speak to it. Stop praying. Hello. Make me feel good. Go to a sauna and feel good.
Yeah.
Amen. We need to know the word so that we can live victoriously.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah. It's time for us to worship the Lord in the giving of our tithes and offerings. And so let's prepare our hearts to do so. Yes, clap your hands because it's a time for being blessed. We're now going to take two and three offerings. We receive one offering. Amen. So if you're accustomed to being asked to give two and three times, wrong place. We will invite you to obey the word that tells us to give. Give our offerings. All right. We tithe because it is an ordinance. And the Bible says that the devourer is rebuked for the sake of the tither. How many of you who tithe have found blessings in being a tither? You've had the devourer rebuked. Amen. How many of you have been blessed as a result of giving to the Lord? Amen. You don't need to be, I don't know, I hear this, so I'm going to say it. You don't need to be concerned about Pastor or I playing the racetracks. Amen. Or going anywhere playing Mega Dollar, whatever that stuff is, Lotto or whatever that is. We don't gamble. We pay tithes. We are tithers. We are givers. And so don't be concerned. I ain't giving the pastor, the money doesn't go to us. It goes into our church fund. Amen. Well, I just love it. These children are leading out. And so if you have tithes or offerings, you're going to worship the Lord with, bring them. If you have plastic and you want to use that, you can go right toward the front door. That can be facilitated as well. If you need an envelope, raise your hand and the ushers will give you one. The Lord loves a cheerful giver. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. We're going to baptize two people shortly. Be in prayer for them. The water is flowing. Praise God. Anybody else desire to give? Have all given who desire?
Not yet. Not
right.
Blessed be the name of the Lord, Most High.
Come on and join in.
Blessed be.
Christ. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Because of her confession of faith, in the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, we're praying for you, sister. Hallelujah. We now baptize Laquita Shirley in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Whoa. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bless the Lord. All right, let's stand. I don't know nothing about the pastor. We baptized two and presented themselves. All right. Brothers, you know who you are. Brothers, you know who you are. Brother Stewart wants to meet you up here on the stage. Those children who said they wanted to receive the infilling of the Holy Spirit, go with Pastor right now. Stand up, Pastor. Let them. And anybody else who wants to receive the infilling, go now. Follow her. Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love. The fellow of kindred minds. Kindred minds is like to that of love. Now all together, let's sing it again. Blessed be the tie that binds. In case you don't know what that is, that's the blood of Jesus. Our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship. That it is the entrance of your word that dispels all darkness, that we walk in the light of your word. Thank you that we are empowered by the Holy Spirit to be obedient to you. Thank you, Lord, that as we obey, we receive your grace to walk it out in the name of Jesus. So as we leave this place, we thank you that your word promises that you'll never leave us nor forsake us. And although we leave this assembly, Lord, we thank you that you're forever with us. As we go in, as we come out, your angels are encamped around and about us in the name of Jesus. We're covered by your blood in Jesus' name. Help us to be exemplary as children of the King in the name of the Lord Jesus. Help us to show forth your light in dark places in Jesus' name. Help us, Lord, to be reflective of your peace that goes beyond all of our understanding, that it does keep our heart and our mind in Jesus' name. Now we surrender ourselves to you. We ask you to have your way, lead us and guide us in the name of the Lord Jesus. And we give you glory, honor, and praise, and those in agreement say amen. Amen. The Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Lord Jesus, you are dismissed. Oh, would you please turn your folders in? Would you please not move? And every Brother James, would you collect all those folders that are coming to the end? Just pass them to the aisle. And Brother James will pick them up.